Bonjour, mes petites. Je suis Professor George Lees. And I went to Kelso High School, as you know. And I'm very interested in the French Connection and the crème de la crème, which emerged from the French Connection in the form of the Piso Windsor bloodline that we've been talking about in the last few days. Let me explain the links to the Berties of the Windsor family. What stammers like that when it's on the verge of World War II? You remember them sharing the just to let them know it's us joke just before we went into World War II. This is the lessons about Bertie in the Kelso High School French connection rather. Right then, the Bertillon family, I remember it fondly. I've pinched some of my textbooks from Kelso High School and I've still got them in the attic. My wife may dispossess me of those, but let's have a look at how we were taught French in those early days in Kelso High School. It was the Bertillon family. Bertie. Oh no, I've got a sound problem. Let's take it back in time. Kelso High School pupils, wake up! You need to prove you're the worth of your O levels.
Bonjour, je suis Marie-Claude. Bonjour, je suis Alain. Bonjour, je suis Madame Bertillon.
Bonjour, je suis Monsieur Bertillon. Bonjour, je suis Chevalier de Métier.
Oh no.
Bonjour, je suis Valérie Giscard d'Estaing. Bonjour, je suis Gaston Bertrand.
Oh, sorry guys. I forget to put the energy plug in the computer. It should warm up soon. Right then, so that was the Bertillon family. Yeah, and what we're going to have to do now is return my computer from hibernation, which is very interesting. It will give me time to explain some things what I've discovered. I can't say that in French properly. It's got all sorts of tenses in the statement, and I'm ever so tense about letting the news out that Andy Murray is a massive part of the Christianity fraud, the Windsor fraud, the world owners fraud, and the fault line that we've explained in the Dunblane region before has a huge role to play in the massive quakes that occurred in 79 AD in Scotland when we launched the Bible through the Agricola team that was here then. Okay? Now, let's see if I can return the computer to viability. Say a little prayer. If you can find a frog, give it a kiss. I'm going to show you that little fairy tale too, because the frogmoor jokes are really quite vicious about the British elites and the world owners. We've just had a team of 5 Corbies eating the apples from the orchard across the road. Yeah, that's the Corbies. Yet that are in Shakespearean output about Scottish monarchy and the havens at Glam's Castle. All of it is a stitch up and all of it is very elite stitch up. I cannot say that in French. Do you get the creme de la creme bit now? Yeah, that's the Almond Valley joke. And all the way across that region, you've got the Antonine Wall, and all of it is the launch of false Christianity out of the fucking Roman Empire for a huge belly laugh. But the people that come and become the Bertillons, and that come and become the ruling elites in Scotland, are actually the French connection. Yeah? And they are the Murrachs and the Murrays and the Murrays. I've been looking for it for months. Every night when I go to bed, the skylight in my house is lit up by a Murray eel, and I have been unable to find the connection. I found the connection to the Piso currency in the Philippines, remember? And the Piso and the Peso currency in Mexico, and the eel was part of that story. And I found the eel on one coat of arms in Germany, in the Hanseatic League region, yesterday, but it still was not the telling tale. The telling tale is that the Moray region in Scotland is where they transitioned from the French Bertillon regimes into the Scottish elites, and it becomes all sorts of Scottish names that are really, really famous, like Kerr and Murray and all of the elites up here. I need to get the pages open because my memory, as you know, is slightly frail. And I'll just quickly give you a skim through the sites that are open. It's not. Oh, sorry, I'm using the wrong keyboard. So let's play you. So that was the Bertillon family. That was the books and the French family that we focused on through all of our French classes with Mr. Taylor. And Mike Taylor does not seem very able to speak openly with me. His dad's name was Hiram, and I believe that may be a link to the Freemasonic movement, which the French nation is a fucking expert in it. At the, you know, the that brings the whole world to its knees, particularly in wartime. And I'm going to show you some of the royal factors in bringing the whole world to its knees in wartime in the next couple of YouTube videos. So let's get away from the Bertillons, okay? So that was a search for La Famille Bertillon, and they were the family that were used to show us all of the domestic trivia about how to translate English into French and to speak fluently. Let's have a look at the myths about the frogs. And you...
Voilà, je vais parler un petit peu avec ma carte de France. Je l'ai dit.
Right then, one hopes that one will not be banned up for copyright reasons. Because they still burn people in France. Particularly if you're very important in the Christianity story. And all of it looks ever so romantic, because that's a French saint who gets burnt at the stake. You might have heard of her before. Right then, here we go. The Frog Prince, a short story. It's not actually willing to play at the moment, I'm not sure why.
The Frog Prince.
Oh, please, YouTube, give me a break. So I've now got the power on, and we've just...
What?
not keen to play.
Once upon a time, there lived a beautiful princess. One day, while she was playing with her favorite golden ball, she threw it too far and it fell into the palace well. She cried, thinking that the water was too deep for her to find the golden ball. A frog nearby heard the princess crying. He told her that if he found the ball for her, she should take him back to the palace with her. She should love him, let him eat from her plate, and let him sleep on her bed. The princess agreed, but as soon as she got her ball, she grabbed it and ran away. The frog went to the palace and called for her. The princess told her father everything that had happened. Her father asked her to keep her promise. As soon as the frog saw the princess, he began croaking happily. He ate from her plate and also slept on her bed. She hated to have the frog around her, but she slowly began growing fond of the frog. Then, one morning when the princess woke up, she saw that in the place of the frog, there was a handsome young prince. The prince thanked her and explained that a witch had cursed him. He would have to live like a frog till he met a kind girl who would love him, let him eat from her plate, and sleep on her bed. Very soon, the frog prince and the princess were married and ruled their kingdom for many years.
Did you see the wee thing with the big ears and the trunk? That's the pooka, by the way. Winnie the pooka. All the way through world history for a massive belly laugh. And Mrs. Simpson, yeah? She completely dismembered most of Europe in that totally premeditated gesture. And she, maybe, was able to speak French late in her life as an American citizen, because she lived in leafy Paris for the whole of the Great Conflict, and she was buried at Frogmore by the current Queen when she was just approaching her 60th birthday. Let me show you that. Frogmore is Windsor, and Windsor Park is one of those 300 massive castles owned by the British Royals, the richest firm on the globe. The firm, as Greg Halleck calls them, and David Icke calls them. BBC News, 1986. Duchess of Windsor funeral. Flags at half mast. That's the British flag. Yeah? And the knavish tricks that they play to stay in those 300 castles.
Earl Borough, whose name she bore, was strangely hushed for the funeral of the Duchess of Windsor. Flags at half-mast, save for the royal standard. The routine of the castle went on unchanged, as a few of the curious stood in the sunshine as mourners arrived. A wreath from the government with the note, with deepest sorrow. Inside St. George's Chapel, away from the cameras, the service was simple and stripped of all trappings of state. The Queen, the Duke of Edinburgh, and the Queen Mother sat in the choir opposite the coffin of dark English oak, which was surmounted by a single wreath sent by the Queen. On the stroke of four, the coffin was borne from the chapel on the shoulders of eight Welsh guardsmen. In his days as the world's Prince Charming, the Duke of Windsor was the regiment's Colonel-in-Chief. The Queen and the Duke, the Queen Mother and Princess Anne followed behind. On these same steps, only 8 days ago, they stood at the end of the Thanksgiving service for the Queen's 60th birthday. How many thoughts must have turned this afternoon to how different history might have been but for the woman whose funeral it was today. The Queen Mother, who so opposed the abdication in 1936, knowing how heavy the burden would be for her husband and her daughter, Princess Elizabeth, then only 10.
So, that's the maid. Yet you understand her now. She is the woman that was picked from downstairs, yet from the household, to replace the woman who prudently screwed off to Denmark to flee from the stammering king because he was an imbecile. Yeah, and she's the one that shares with the whole world the racehorse Gigi jokes. Giddy up, Gigi. Yeah, you are the joke about my family being pretenders to this throne, and me being totally illegitimate because I'm from the downstairs sector, but I'm one of the most genial royals in the family, which is why I'm so popular. And I get inseminated with Winston Churchill's semen so that I can sire my child and my both of my female princesses, and the one who's got who's got the boyfriend called Snowden becomes quite an embarrassment for the family, really. Yeah, and all of it is done with great dignity. Yeah, and all of it is a project that steals from and kills all of the world's war dead and all of the world's religious faithful. Let's look at some more of the hypocrisy. Yeah, I've discovered that the publishers of the book that was the first novel I ever read in my life, when I was able to read round about age 6, was published by the same people that published all of the Peter Rabbit and Beatrix Potter output. And you should see who's still on the boards of them. Yeah, John Noakes and all of the Blue Peter heroes, massive profiteering. Yeah, and all of the Scots of Notting Hill, all of the links to the Scots of the Borders region, and all of the links to the Dukes of Buccleuch, and all of those people are still publishing the jokes about Peter Rabbit that take you back to Lagos in the time of Alexander the Great. And the bloodline stories in Scotland are really, really sinister. And really quite embarrassing for my neighbour Guy Innes-Ker.
And had decided not to go on from the chapel for the burial at Frogmore. That would be left to the Queen and the Duke and the Prince and Princess of Wales. It was the Prince who'd sought to apply balm to the old family wounds, calling the Duchess Aunt Wallace and welcoming her to Britain on her last two visits, before this final return, not home, but to her husband's side. During the service, there was a profound sense of peace and reconciliation, almost as if you could hear a page being turned and a book finally closed. One of the next generation played unconcerned at a castle window as the woman who shook the throne of an empire passed by on her way to Frogmore, where members of her staff, her doctor, and an old friend joined the royal family to see the Duchess laid to rest next to the Duke under a spreading plane tree. The plate on the coffin read, Wallace, Duchess of Windsor, 1896-1986. No letters HRH, nor will they be carved on her marble tombstone, though that was her husband's dying wish. But clearly, it's too late for that.
Wallace, you may remember, is also the name...
Royal Borough, whose name she bore, was strangely hushed for the funeral of the Duchess of Windsor.
Of one of the heroes in Scotland's history. Yeah, that's a male gender person called William. Yeah? And he is not at all connected, I believe, to the Bertie jokes. But let's take you up to Scotland and see how all of the Picts and all of the indigenous people are chased the fuck out of there by the invading French elites or the Belgian elites, and all of them come out of the Roman court after Christianity has been launched. Where shall I take you first? Let's remind you of the launch of that Christianity. Yeah, so there's the Piso tab, and there is the family trees that take me into the Bertillon family. Do you get it? 6 generations of Dagoberts, yeah? And all of it, they think it's hilarious. Look at the Christian nature of the bigamy in their marriages. I've yet to tell you in a video that Queen Victoria was the first person to be married in a virgin white wedding dress in world history. That's the start of the trend that every one of your families have to pay for. And Queen Victoria, sadly, was not a virgin when she married Prince Albert. Bertie. Yeah, it is relentless, okay? So you see that even in our French classes, they're taking the piss about the claimants to the throne that becomes the Windsor throne and becomes the owners of the whole world, because the American presidents are in exactly the same bloodline. Okay, so there we have the Bertillons were the family in our first ever French textbooks at Kelso High School. And then let's go back up till you see some of the famous names in the Piso family. And we've got the Goths and the Visigoths. That's the German, French and the Frankish nations. And you've got the evil childs and you've got the cloven hoof jokes and the three, four-leafed clover jokes that eventually take you into the Irish religion, okay? And you've got the evil child and the Rothschild become the red branch of those breakaways, okay? And all of it I can now put together. There's the red branch, and you marry that with the child, and suddenly you've got the world's leading moneylenders. Roth is red. That's Radbot, the Swiss king. Okay? And what you've got is, this is right in the middle of what they call the Dark Ages. The plague is everywhere around these families, and it will not take a lot of imagination for you to imagine why God inflicts them with that. And the Andover is in Hampshire, where the drug running triumvirates were run by the people that sired that little baby that was looking round the corner. Because all of Queen Elizabeth's children beyond Princess Anne were sired by other people for other motives, and Prince Philip had been kicked out of her bedroom already. Let's take it up to the famous names and show you how close they are. Okay, so here we've got Merovech Merovi. Now that may not, if you're not a good scholar, link into anything I've just told you, but when you look at that, yeah, it's the Murrays, and it's William of Hugh of Merovia. This is the Murray link so long hinted at. And my neighbours are called the Veitches, and the Veitch is part of the joke. Yeah, you can see it. And these are the merry jokes in the Lord of the Rings film too. Okay, there's the Magnus connection. And just a few generations back, we get to Marcus Aurelius and Constantine. There's Constantine flashing by. He's the one that started to crucify the Jews and to launch Christianity big time, to launch big buildings. Yeah, and the Cluny Abbey in France is the biggest. There's Marcus Aurelius, the legendary figurehead, and there is Julianus Calpurnius Piso. That was when the family were fighting amongst themselves about the release of Revelations and the story that the man, who's this man here, Arius Calpurnius Piso, he was depicted by his son, who was killed by the family because he was depicted as the devil. Okay, and there's the Mariams and the Gaiuses and links to the chickens and all of the links to Fox News and the cock crowing three times, and for them it is a huge belly laugh. So let's see how many generations we have to go down till we get to the Bertie jokes in France. Yeah, and when you look at Asterix the Gaul and all of the output of Walt Disney in America, it takes you to the Fowlers. Okay, there's Pepin of Landen. That is right next to Waterloo in Belgium. Landen, okay? So we've been through the Bertillon bit in France, where the king is allowed to have five wives as the Christian leader. Yeah, very unjust on poor old King Henry, in inverted commas, who was allowed to have six, and I forget how many he beheaded. These are the moral leaders of our religious world. And then the Bega family are also Frankish and Germanic, they link to the Martell Champagne Company. And there's a Professor Begg in Christchurch, the shaky, quaky English city in New Zealand. Yeah, and they thought it was hilarious to have me booted out of their community. And there's Pepin's, the short Bertha, Bertha, Big Bertha is the German canon, and then you've got Charlemagne, the huge belly laughs about the head of the Holy Roman Empire being allowed to have five wives. Mostly Frankish. And then Louis the Pious, and that takes you right back into the Piso family. Yeah, Judith, yeah, that's the joke about Judith and the Jewess who was able to behead Holofernes. Yeah, and we're getting down into Germany and Bavaria, where Hitler came from, and the links to the Rothschilds and Hitler were explained in the videos I've made portraying the life and the output of Greg Hallett. And some of them have had thousands of visits now, and the one that I listened to again this morning for the public here is really tragic. All wars are unfinished, they lead to all new wars, and all of them are totally premeditated by civilized, in inverted commas, leading elites like the people that we're reading off this list on the left. Okay, let me take you back to some hard facts now. I was quite stunned and stupefied by the links to Scotland for a time, and I could not see the significance of the Moray Eel that the gods kept putting in front of me. Every night when I go to bed for 6 weeks I've been looking for the solution to this. This afternoon I found it, and the skies turned heavenly. Yeah, it's just amazing. And there you can see the eel-like creature. Can you see the fin on the back? Right then, here we go. So this is Clan Murray, and before I go Clan Murray and show you that, I'm going to show you this character, who was the person that made my mind up that I've now solved this problem. Okay, the predecessors of Clan Murray in Scotland are these, a person called Friskin. They are Flemish, yeah, that's from the low regions of Holland, just to the north of France. Yeah, where there's a place called Dunkirk that you might have heard of in European history before. Okay, this is fascinating. They are the Flemish Kers, Duff, Erskines and Sutherlands. Yeah, that's the Sutherlands that are the massive landowners. The Duchess of Sutherland lives near here. They've got massive estates right up on the north coast of Scotland, like the Vesties have. Yeah, and all of Scotland has been carved up by what look like French incomers. And the Picts, yeah, the people that painted themselves blue and that were depicted in William Wallace's armies with the blue faces, yeah, they are not really part of the story, because they are culled by the mercenary armies from Germania and all across Northern Europe that come here in 79 AD when Agricola is the Governor General. And we have the same quake, same year that they have the quake and the volcanic eruption in of Vesuvius onto the Villa Papyri, which was the family home for the Bible authors. Okay, let's have a wee look at Friskin, because it is very, very insightful, because there's only a few paragraphs in this one, it will not take long. Friskin died before 1171. So do you see the links to William the Conqueror? Yeah? 1066. Hastings. Yeah, and then all the way across to Paisley and the pie joke and the Paisley and the cross keys out of the Cluny Abbey becoming the saltire flag in Scotland. So Friskin died before 1171, was a Flemish nobleman who settled in Scotland during the reign of King David the First, who built Kelso Abbey. I think they were the Benedictine movement. Yeah, all of them are warlords, launch Christianity with the sword, same shape as the Christian cross, and by killing and running protection rackets all across Europe, they become the progenitors of the Murray and Sutherland families. Yeah, that is David Murray. It is the massive Murray holders of the title, and you'll see who the current one is further down. It is the launch of Andy Murray, and Andy Murray was a historic colleague of one William Wallace. And he was killed in one of the early battles in the Scottish Freedom Revolution, and unfortunately William Wallace is deemed to be a superior an inferior deputy to the Murray who died. And unfortunately Andy Murray lives in Dunblane, and all of the shenanigans in Dunblane are a perfect cover for all of the stuff that are revealed about Greg Hallett, about the F-U-C-K word and the fornication under consent of the king and the launch of the royal brothels. Everything that happened in Britain, all of the ordinary citizens were persecuted. There were summer wars every summer to keep the numbers down, and so that the elites could have their orphans as children and sexual victims all through human history. Yeah, and they're really proud of that, and in the royal bedroom to this day it still carries on, allegedly. Poor old Princess Sophie. I'd love to console her at some time in the future. Yeah. Okay, let's carry on down. It's not long, this story. That's the Sutherlands that sent the colonists to the colonies. And Brad Sutherland is back in Oxford. He had his heart attack when he was aged about 23 in my PhD programme. He followed me to Britain like the Connolly guys, and all of them are traitors to me. Yeah, and he's now playing cricket in Oxford in the neuroscience sector, and he's totally ignoring everything that I report on the robbery of all of their student charges in the undergraduate community. £60,000 a year. Sorry, that's gone up to £66,000 a year. We discussed that with the new £4,000 a year enhancement on the fees this very month. Okay, so they're connected to the Douglases, and that is very interesting for me, because I'm telling you also that they are likely to be connected to the Kers in my region, the feudal landlords. Yeah, that's Guy Innes-Ker. That's Guy Jesus Ker, for a laugh. Can you see how ruthless the families are? Guy Innes-Ker is a relatively civilized man. I know he's a kind of decent bloke. Yeah, but when they harbour jokes like this lifelong, and they're prepared to steal through the stock market scams that I've revealed for you already, then it's no wonder to me that they get the cancers. No one has ever tried to connect to me from the palace, other than the medics, to say that trying to get meetings with world leaders who behave this way is an indication that I am behaving insanely. Yeah? Dr. Fingland is not really a courageous man, yet he just works from the back room. Freskin was said to have come to the lowlands of Scotland from Flanders and thence to Moray in the north. That's Moray, yeah? There's a bishop of Moray, yeah, in 1200, within 100 years of them flitting across the channel, yeah, the Bishop Murray is in place. And do you remember that Madonna came to Scotland and was married in an elite hotel, an elite house that she bought, I think, in the Moray region? And we've taken magnificent holidays there in the past. Yeah, there's a massive airbase right next door, and I was looking that up last night, because last night when I made my video and I was watching the Devil's Advocate, we were still having planes flying around my home at 12 o'clock midnight. Yeah. I do not want to launch a revolution. I want a peaceful transition into funding our democracy as it should be funded. Okay? So this is, he came to Moray in the north. From a charter granted by one of his sons, by King William the Lion, it can be ascertained that Freskin held from King David the lands of Strathbrook, that's another badger joke you might notice, in West Lothian. Remember the links of the Brocks in the Longshanks interlocks? Yeah, that lead to the badger culls and all of the cover-ups of the people that are involved. And that is other families like Duffus, Rosyle, Inchiquel, Mackier, and Kintry in Moray. Sorry, that's the regions where they operate from. The name Freskin is Flemish, and in the words of Geoffrey Barrow, it is virtually certain that Freskin belonged to a large group of Flemish settlers who came to Scotland in the middle decades of the 12th century. So that's the YMCA going west, young man. And were chiefly to be found in West Lothian and in the valley of the Clyde. Okay? So right across into the other end of the Antonine Wall and right across through the West Lothian region, through the Almond Valley and everything I've told you about Miss Jean Brodie and the Scottish fascists, it's the same people. And do you see the links to the Fleming family as a surname? Also linked to trading through the Hanseatic League and across that Baltic coast and the lowlands from Holland and northern France. Several Flemings who had lands in the Moray bestowed upon him. This seems to have been an attempt by the kings of Scotland to replace the native Gaelic nobility. All around the world, it's the same story. The indigenous people, the power base that have been planted there by God, are taken out by the new sophisticates with the more established weaponry, and everything that they do is a genocide. Yeah, that's the Gaelic nobility eradicated, who had resisted their rule and prevented them from forming a cohesive kingdom. Yeah, that is the chaos that we now have, and they describe it as a cohesive kingdom, most notably in the 1130 uprising led by Angus, Earl of Moray. No mention of the bishop yet. And what you've got with the bishop is the place that is called the abbey is in a place called, and they're looking for spivey at the moment in the journalist sector that covers everybody's truths up. So spivey is somebody like me that writes articles about fraud and paedophilia. He's gone missing or he's been kidnapped or something, and the place where the abbey is that the Moray bishop runs the abbey is Spivey Castle or Spiny Castle. Okay, and here we go. This is the story about the Morovingian families and the bloodlines and the lizards, as David Icke describes them. Yeah, it's the same descriptors for these people that end up in Scotland. Freskin probably had one only son, William. It's sometimes said that they had two others, Hugh and Andrew, but these may in fact have been the sons of William. William inherited his father's lands and took the name de Moravia, okay? Or of Moray, yeah? And it is the Morovingian link to the David Icke story and all of the links all the way to the Windsors through the elites all over Europe that take you back to the Pisos and then take you back to the Ptolemies and then take you back to Alexander the Great, yeah? Do you see it? Moravia, Moray family. Moray or Moray family became prolific in Scotland, and how could it take me 6 weeks to find something as simple as that? And their chief now holds the title Duke of Atholl. And in the supermarket yesterday I met a woman from the Atholl estate with lovely jodhpurs and a lovely butt under the jodhpurs, and she had the title for the estate, which is further down the page. It is the Blair estate, because Blair Athol takes you into the socialist prime minister who brutalised the Holy Lands, Tony Blair. I don't know whether or not he's involved in the ownership of Blair Athol in Perthshire, but one would not be at all surprised. Hugh, one of William's sons, acquired a large tract of land in Sutherland. Okay, do you see the links? That's the Vesties, the Sutherlands, who sent the colonists to the colonies. His son William took the surname Sutherland and was created Earl of that region in the 1230s, a title which is still held by his descendants today. And then you've got the Douglas connection. They have this very, very similar colours and icons on their coat of arms. Okay, and this is the Black Douglases in the Borders region, and that King David is the man who launched all of the Borders abbeys. Okay, and you've got Brickeus the Douglas, son of William, Lord of Douglas, and here's the Bishop of Moray in 1203. So they came 100 years before, and suddenly Christianity's flourishing, and the people that are at the head of the estate become the head of the local cathedral. A man named Freskin of Cairdale. Do you get it? Yeah? All of them are Baloch relations. All of them have come from the Frankish side of the Channel, and all of them have come from the fascist region, which is Holland. Yeah? And some of them come through Hastings and the south coast. Some of them come through Barwick. Yeah? Berwick. Yeah, and the people that talked to me on the pavements, all of them know Jeff Barrick came and talked to me today in a very civilised way, and there's the cover for the man who's been disappeared. This is Spiny Cathedral. Spy Nye Cathedral. That's the knights who say me. Okay, do you get it? St Ninian in Scotland. It's a total fucking stitch-up for 2,000 years, and it's taken 1,200 of them to get into the whole of Scotland, and to get rid of the Pictish nation, and to get rid of the other indigenous people, the ones, the Gaelic speakers. Okay? So, there you've got the launch of Cairdale, and when I looked up the origins of guy Innes-Ker and his bloodline, there's a bit of a tiff about whether or not the Inneses are the legitimate claimants, and someone's allowed to cast judgment on that. But what you have right at the very first of the 12 dukes that have been put in place, I think guy Innes-Ker is the 12th, the first one was contending for the title with a Murray, and I now entirely understand it, and the Freskins are the launch of the Murrays and of the people that live in Cairdale. With one R. Okay? The connection is further supported by the similarity of the family's arms. Both bear three silver stars on blue in varying arrangements. Belief in the common descent of the Murrays and Douglases were certainly extant in the early 15th century. The Murrays, but Murrays were contenders as the first of the 12 Dukes of Roxburgh. That's my notes on the side there, and it's right next door to RAF Kinloss, and where Madonna had her wedding. And that is very similar to the wedding that was held in the north of Scotland for the people in the Notting Hill movie. Yeah, it was an American woman that was getting spliced. And it's all the same story, and they think it's really, really funny. Okay, and there's the Na-Na stories as well. Yeah, so the knights that say nee, if the pythons laugh at it, you know that it is a really vicious joke. against something that is a huge part of world history, and this has taken us all over Scotland, right from the tip of Sutherland at the top to the bottom of Scotland in the Tweed Valley, which is the Merse, Mary's arse. Right then. And so let's have a look at Clan Murray and see what we've highlighted there, because some of the names that we've just mentioned are also listed here, and it takes you into the history of Wallace and the rest. Okay, so and the Bothwells. So here is the Clan Murray shield. He's got a knife in one hand and he's got one of the keys in the other hand. Can you see that? It's not two keys to open the lock to our country. It's now a violent route. And the cross keys that are the saltire icon on the flag, now become the yellow and black colours that we've learned so much about in the fascist and Rothschild worlds. And you've got the laurel leaves around his belly and around his head. And you've got the fleur-de-lis turned up and looking a little bit like a willy and a couple of testicles right below the flag. Okay, and let's see what they've got to say. Okay, so a demi-savage with laurels on his waist and his right hand a dagger, in his left a key, all proper. Motto: Firth, fortune, and fill the fetters. Not sure what that means. To be fetted. To be fetted like Fettes and Tony Blair and all of the Metropolitan Police trainees. Okay? Region, Highlands, plant badge, butcher's broom or juniper. The broom is the same icon for Plantagenets and Longshanks. We have a really, really treasonous history. As long as you get a cash bung, it does not matter what you do to your citizens' base. The Athol Highlanders are the pipers, and there we've got the sad indictment on their flag that you've got the three stars, for the Black Douglas and for the other wing of the Murray family. But you've got the Mummers, the Rotary Club icon. It's sick. You see it? That's the Isle of Man icon. It's the same icon as the spoken wheel thing in every one of those wagon inn pubs all across our country. And the Bruce's, Bruce Murray, is the current incumbent. 12th Duke of Athol, and there's the sign that was on the lovely jodhpur bearing woman's ass yesterday. It was Blair Estate. Okay, and my family used to live up there, and all of them came to the borders. So the Bothwell is links to the borders, to Langham and to Queen Mary's murder or execution, call it what you like. Bothwell was one of Queen Mary's lovers. I believe he died in Norway. If anything that you learn in the Jedburgh buildings is to be believed, the progenitor of the Clan Murray was Freskin. It's the first time I've heard of him. It takes you into huge numbers of possibilities, because Erskine is a massive business magnate in Scotland. And it's a mysterious branch of Kersdal again. Okay, he lived during the 12th century. It's been claimed he was Pictish, but it is much more likely he was a Flemish knight, one of a ruthless group of warlords. Are you listening to that? That's the launch of Christianity, sweep right across Europe and right up through Europe to the Baltic coast. They're there in the year 800. It's taken them a little bit longer, because all of the massive estates that they own all across Europe and to the south are part of the previous conquests. One of a ruthless group of warlords who were employed by the Norman kings to to pacify their new realm. Pacify is not in inverted commas. After the Norman conquest of England, David I of Scotland, who was brought up in the English court, employed such men to keep hold of the wilder parts of his kingdom. That's all of his kingdom. Right from the top, right to the bottom. All parts. Just as they launch the Bible. And granted to Freskin lands in West Lothian. The ancient Pictish kingdom of So West Lothian is Miss Jean Brodie's Crammond. The ancient Pictish kingdom of Moray was also given to Freskin, and this put an end to the remnants of that old royal house. In a series of astute political moves, Freskin and his sons intermarried with the old house of Moray to consolidate their power. Freskin's descendants were designated by the surname de Moravia of Moray in the Norman language, and this became Moray in Lowland Scottish language. That's the Merovingian dynasty that just predates the Carolingian dynasty that is on the Piso-Windsor bloodline, that is that tab. Yeah? And has been articulately explained by David Icke. But because he calls them lizards, one has a tendency to put that down as conspiracy theory. All of this is the brutal fact of how Scotland and its citizens have been disappeared in favour of the sheep, and the colonies get the citizens. The original Earls of Sutherland, chiefs of Clan Sutherland, descendant from Freskin's eldest grandson, Hugh, that's Shug in the Rabsy Nisbet jokes. Hugh de Moravia. Yeah? And do you see the links to the Ike descriptors and to the Carolingian successors of these? We'll take you back to the timeline for the Pisos and the Windsors in a few minutes. William de Moravio and Sir Walter Murray became Lord of Bothwell, one of the lovers of Mary Queen of Scots. Clan Oliphant, yeah, who may well be the Pooka joke, yeah, the elephant Oliphant, yet we don't have elephants in Scotland, but we have a panda in the zoo with a food budget of £70,000. The Piso menagerie, everything for the Pisos is funded liberally. He was a regent of Scotland in 1255. He also started the construction of Bothwell Castle, right up in the Langham region, which is where the Armstrong, the legendary revolutions come from. It was the seat of the chiefs of Clan Murray until 1360, when it passed over to Clan Douglas. During the Wars of Scottish Independence, Andrew Murray took up the cause of Scottish independence against Edward I of England. You might have heard of him. He's the one with the brocks in these interlocks. And this lot have also got the Middletons as elite landowners in Scotland. I'll show you that listing later on. Okay, so the Middletons interlock with Longshanks. All of the people that are the Dukes of Arundel, the Dukes of Norfolk, yeah, and it's a massive power base all across from the south coast to the north coast and to Scapa Flow, yeah, where we sunk the ships in World War II, and all of it just keeps rolling on. And he was joined by William Wallace in the conflict against Edward I. Andrew Murray was killed following the Scottish victory at the Battle of Stirling Bridge in 1297, after which Wallace assumed command of Scottish forces. It has been suggested by the posh people in Oxbridge that the whole war might have taken a different course if Murray had survived the battle at Stirling Bridge, as he had shown significant skill in pitched battle, which Wallace lacked. His son was Sir Andrew Murray, 4th Lord of Bothwell and 3rd Regent of Scotland. Yeah, that's next in line to the king, I think, who married Christian Bruce. Yeah, the Bruces in the story, the man behind the helmet that had William Wallace daubed on and executed, eventually disemboweled, actually. A sister of King Robert the Bruce. This married, oh, that's his sister, Christian Bruce. This Andrew Murray fought at the Battle of Halidon Hill in 1333. So this is a bit boring. I'm going to take you back to the Piso timeline because it's much more interesting for me. Strathearn is a fault line in Scotland. That's through Dunblane. Yeah, it's through all of the places where the Antonine Wall has been built. Yeah, and Archibald the Grim is highly likely to have German roots. Lord of Galloway, and that's the Grimms that are in the Göttingen Seven. Two university professors specialising in the demonisation of other countries and talking up the Aryan master race. All wars. And we've got Lord of Galloway and later Earl of Douglas. So we're into the places where the people come from that are the mercenary army leaders in the Christian Wars. The 30 Years' War, it was Robert Maxwell, Lord of Galloway. Right then. So I'm just going to show you a list of names. I don't think I've highlighted any more. That's the Murray Tartan. That's the Mully of Tully Barden Tartan. Now they've got several options. Oh no, just the two. Jacobite Rising, everything is a cult. And it just keeps going on and on and on. Okay, Culloden. Yeah, do you get the joke about killing Odin now? Odin is the Norse god. Right. So, let's have it show you the Scottish elites. It's quite amusing, really. Yeah? So this is a list of the clans, and we saw on the Queen's Holdings the other day that the Scottish power base is really, really important in the back room to making the firm that the Queen's run the richest on the globe. So you've got Agnews, Anstruthers, Arbuthnots. Every one of these families are in the speculative societies. Yeah, and that was the last published in the early 1990s. Arthur, Bannerman, the Bannerman Burkes, Barclay, Borthwick. You heard of Barclay before? In an agricolan context, with the Barclay being the barley, and the Barclay being the banking dynasties that I used to work with in the professoria in New Zealand. Borthwick, Boyd, Boyle, Mrs. Boyd, Mrs. Boyle, Brodie, Jean, Brune, Bruce, Buchan, that's the Tweedsmuirs, Burnett, Cameron, that is the Lochiels, Campbell, and it is the Camerons of Canada that invented electroconvulsive therapy for psychiatry and torture. Carmichael, Carnegie, you've heard of them, those are the ones that sell the drones. Cathcart, Charteris, Chatton, Chisholm. Yeah, I've got a friend called Chisholm, yeah, who's got a son in the local coppers, and I talk to them all of the time. I did not know until this morning that they are in the Scottish elite landowning families. Cochrane, Colquhoun, Colville, Cranston, Alistair. He's a revolutionary, he believes in the Barcelona football model, and he runs that as a councillor for Hoyk. Yeah, where they're right at the top of the Teviot Valley, where blind Prince George of Cumbria and Teviotdale was the lover of Queen Victoria. And did I tell you the whole of that story about Queen Victoria's persecution and her virginity being lost way before she became a mature teenager even? Crichton, yeah, legendary Freemasons, coming, common, yeah, they're friends of my family, they're very spirited rugby players, and I'm led to believe that they were murdered by the bad guys early in the story. That may not all be true. Cunningham, Darrick, Davidson, oh, the names that Gordon Bowden uses in vain. Dewar, Drummond, oh, Drummond. Kev at the with the three arrows in his hand, and Marie at the eye mouth. The accountants, Dunbar, Dundas, Jury, Elliot, Elphinstone, Erskine, Farquharson, Ferguson, Governor Generals in New Zealand. When I was there, I met them. Ah, they sadly broke their ankle when they came home. All of it, God premeditates. Forbes, Forsyth, Fraser. Fraser of Lovett, yeah, that's the Procurator Fiscals at Jed. Gordon, Graham, Grant, Gregor, Grierson, Guthrie, Lord Guthrie, yeah, of Dundee, yeah, my children are being taken into Dundee University by my disloyal wife. I have no input to the decisions that they make. I understand entirely how the universities are defrauded, how the universities are giving them useless products. I have no say in my children's future. Haig, yeah, that's the butchers. Haldane, Hamilton, that's the Hesses. Hannies, yeah, that's the people on the clock face. Hay, Henderson, Home, Hope, Henderson. Yeah, mentioned it a couple of times. Hunter, Irvin, Jardine, that's Andy Irvin, yet the massive fraudster in the rugby world and in the business world. Jardine, Johnston, we talked about the Jardines in the drug running concept and selling of Mercedes, yeah, in the Queen's Cabal just the other day. Keith, Kennedy, Kerr, two R's. Kincaid, Lamont, you might have heard of that one. Both hemispheres, yeah, all universities that I've worked in. Lisk, Lennox, Envoy, Tumalawi, Leslie, Lindsay, Lockhart, Lumsden, Lyon, McAllister, Wally McAllister, now working with the RBS in Chester, McBean, MacDonald, MacDonald of Clanraid, MacDonald of Kepup, MacDonald of Sleat, MacDonald of Glengarry, MacDonald of Glengarry, sorry, we used to go on our elite holidays to Glengarry. Yeah, my wife's forgotten all about that. I've not had a holiday since 2012. MacDougall, McDowell, McIntyre, Mackay, yeah, Lord Mackay of Clashfern, all of the porridge jokes. Mackenzie, McKinnon, McIntosh, McLachlan, yeah, the Scottish rugby captain. McLean of Lochbuy, McLaren, McClay, Livingstone. Right at the top of the Almond Valley. McLean, McLennan, McLeod, oh, the McLeods, the ship sinkers. Yeah, for Lloyds of London, on the Isle of Skye, running the vestarium and the registry of tartans. McLeod of Lewis, Macmillan, McNab, McNaughton, McNeacal, McNeil, McPherson, McTavish, McThomas, Maitland, McIll, Malcolm, Marr, Marjorie Banks, Matheson, the Justice Secretary, Kenny Matheson Dalgleish, Menzies, that's Mingus if you're proper, Mingus Campbell, Moffat, like the Rector at St Andrews, yeah, the millionaire at BBC Scotland, Moncrief, Montgomery, yeah, like all of the Dukes of Buccleuch and Sarah in the Radio 4 team. Morrison, Munro, Murray, Napier, Rab C. Nisbet's kind, Nicholson, the Ogilvies, sainted now by the Catholic Church, pharma magnates, massive profiteers, Oliphant, Primrose, Ramsey, Rattray, Riddell, I forgot about them, they came with the French connections into the borders, just above Selkirk, huge estates, huge castles still. Robertson, yeah, the man who's on every board, yeah, John Robertson Wright, the Robertson joke is relentless in financial services. Just because it's got the word Rob in it, one presumes. And because it's associated with the black man and the jam jar, Rolo, Scottish second row players, Roses, Russes, Ruthvens of Melrose, Sandylands, Scott, yeah, of Notting Hill, all over the borderland still, Scrimger, my earliest head of Kelso High School that I can remember. I did not know he was a Scottish claimant to the land. Semple, Shaw, Sinclair, Skeen, Stirling, Strange, Stuart of Butte, the Sutherlands of Merton, and the Leveson Inquiry. Yeah, Lord Leveson Gower, close cousins of the Sutherlands. Urquhart, Wallace, Wedderburn, Weems and Wood. Okay, and you've got a whole other list with Andersons and Armstrongs and Arnott Andersons. Yeah, and all of it. Auchinlecks, Baileys, Balfours, Bannatynes, Bethune, Bissett, Blackadder. Yeah, the Bissetts are on Mull and they're in my hometown. Blackadder, yeah, and you should see the place on Mull, yeah, that the Bissetts used to be the tenants for, or the downstairs people for, run by Irish landowners, and it was really, really sinister. Boswell, okay? St. Boswell's. Buchanan, Cairns, Calder, Campbell of Codder, Carruthers, Coburn, Craig, Crawford, Dalmahie, Dalrymple, Dalziel. Yeah, all of the people that get tied into the Friends of Israel. Denniston, Douglas, Duncan. Okay, we've wasted a lot of time on that. Let me show you more of the Piso bloodline and where it takes us. Or what else have I got here? Oh, this is the links, the original groups. So here's the Fowler people. Okay? So what we've done is I've gone through that list of people on this timeline. Okay? And occasionally I look some of them up. And what you get is that you find that they are actually... some of them are the Da Vinci lineage, legendary kings of Salian and Franks. So that's only 400 years AD. And then you go further down and you get into the Merovingian legions that we've just been talking about. And the last remnants of them coming across the channel. So this was earlier, the Childerics and the Moni de Paris lineage. Clovis, Clotilda, and all of them have already got the knights that say knee affiliation to the Christian faith. Okay, and they're headed west really soon. It's actually 500 years later than that. Okay, that is the launch of the French invasion in 1066. Okay, and all of the people from all of that northern European region right up into Holland provided the mercenaries that did for Scotland when Agricola was there, and all of the news was written up by Tacitus. So that's mercenaries from Germania and all along the Baltic coast brutalised Scotland when they had the earthquake in 79 AD. And I'm interested in the Begman, so I had a wee look at him. Let's see what we can find out about him. Saint of the day, Bega. I don't think there was anything sensational. Evan Begg is a relatively decent man, a very highly respected professor in medicine. Begger was born in 615, one of two daughters of a high-ranking official in the Frankish kingdom of Austrasia, covering parts of modern Belgium, Luxembourg, northern France and northern Germany. Can you see the whole of the Roman church movement moved straight up? Yeah. And it moved across into Kievan and Russia, yet the Orthodox movement, and it got right up to the places that are the top of the Baltic coast, and that is Kievan. Yeah, and it is the places like the Polish people come from, Gdansk, and all along that massive trade route, Christianity percolates through there, and it takes 800 years to do that. And you can see that with the channel between them and Britain, it takes quite a long time to get to the leap in 1066. Okay, son of the Bishop of Metz. And everywhere you go, there are dozens and dozens and dozens of churches in every big city worshipping a false icon. Otto is a Piso family member. You're obligated to try and follow him when you see him on the bloodline again, way below Constantine and the people that left in the Nerva Antonine dynasty. So let's see what Otto, and he's a very romantic looking golden figure here. Otto the First, Holy Roman Emperor, like Charlemagne with the five wives. Right. And he's got the hippos with the pointy ears. Isn't it lovely? GG, giddy up. Okay, replica of the Magdeburger Reiter, equestrian monument traditionally regarded as portrait of Otto. Yeah, that's Otto the Onions jokes, and the Onions joke runs right into post-World War II Scottish borders when the French onion sellers came around on their bike selling the Otto onions, just as a joke about religion. And I don't believe that was only confined to the Balfour's farm where I lived. Yeah? It is a huge belly laugh for all of them, and that is the Magdeburg region in Germany. Okay? And I think that could have been where the printing press was invented. Here's the Fowler joke. I should have found him. I might watch the film, because this is the joke about the families, the Piso bloodline, getting into Henry the Fowler. Okay? And it's in a film called Chicken Run. It's actually a series of comic characters and cartoons, but the links there are from Henry the Fowler's reign to Pepin of Landen, that's the Belgians, category of people from Landen, Pepin of Landen, Andover in Hampshire, links already of Pepin to Andover and Andovera. Okay, and the Fowler joke is not immediately obvious to me. Now I'm going to have to watch the movie again. Henry the Fowler, Henry Seal from a document, he's portrayed as a warrior with a spear and a shield. The words are Henricus Rex, King Henry, predecessor Conrad the Younger, Otto the Great, Otto the Illustrious, Otto the Great, spouse is Matilda. And that is the Australian joke. Okay, so this is a joke about modern day Hollywood cartoon output. Yeah, his boss before was Otto, a direct member of the Piso family. And what you've got here is a joke, I forget what the King of Germany from 919 until his death, so we're almost up to 1066. Yeah, first of the Ottonian dynasty of German kings and emperors, generally considered to be the founder and first king of the medieval German state known as East Francia. An avid hunter, he obtained the epithet the Fowler because he was allegedly fixing his birding nets when messengers arrived to inform him that he was to be king. Ah, now I remember, it takes you back to the ancient hieroglyphics in Egypt, yeah, where a lot of the Ptolemy myths come from, and that is the Fowler joke, because the Fowler status is part of the alphabet in the Egyptian religion. Yeah, and remember that the Ptolemies, there were seven of them I think, between the Alexander the Great character, who was Lagos the rabbit, seven Ptolemies before we got into the Roman people, and Herod was another person. He was the great grandfather of Arius Calpurnius Piso, and Arius Calpurnius Piso was the great grandfather of Marcus Aurelius. Do you see the might of that? That's Herod that executed the fictitious Jesus. His decision, along with Pontius Pilate. It's a total stitch-up. And the Hedwig character comes into the Potter films, which are J.K. Rowling's output. I've got a luscious J.K. Rowling lookalike living in my hometown. She talks to me all of the time, and I'm a single person now. Right then. So, sights open on Lagos. The looking joke is vicious, because when you look again at the Piso exposures in the websites that are the Tozzi websites, the Angrifan website, the Angel Fire website, you find that the person who is Luke in the Bible is actually Lucan. And that is the Lord Lucan jokes and the murders in London. Okay, so Lagos of Macedonia, Macedonian statues, Alexander the Great icons, and there is the Joshua jokes and Jesus, you shall call his name Jesus because he will shall save the people from their sins. Where is the Jesus being the son of Joseph? Because let's see if we can find the statement on the vicious joke that Luke, the author who never lived, can't see it there, and let's have a look. I think this is the Windsor bloodline, and it shows you that we start off from the same places. Okay, what else have I found in the last couple of days? It's so dispersed and dishevelled, but the things that I found about Peter Rabbit were quite sensational, and let's see if I can find that. This is about Ra, the sun god, and all of it. You know, it's been mixed in with so many other myths, and it's just, you know, there is no integrity or consistency in the whole story. And when I was uncovering it, the sun was coming pouring out at some point, but because they put in other gods and they mix the names up, it's ever so offensive. And humans pretend that they understand all of it, and that all of the sacrificial victims and the bleeding of bulls and the beheading of them, all of it is just part of the huge fraud that is entraining people's minds and getting them to believe everything that the religious clerics tell them. Okay, and the Sekhmet becomes the Scottish vest, the Semit. And let's see, where is the bit? So this is quite telling. So the hieroglyphics are really interesting. I spent quite a profitable morning on that. And you can see, I thought that this was the long-awaited head of the eel, but it's actually the head of the leopard, and that is that joke. It's the same Piso joke in the Egyptian myths already. It's right through world history. The Egyptians are alleged to be thousands of years before the Pisos and the Christians come on the scene, but the same jokes are shared. Yeah? And oh, the hair.